Shalom, everybody out there in Facebook land. Welcome to a late, special, very, very late edition of Torah Tuesdays. I apologize for the late hour. There's probably not a whole lot of people watching right now. Probably everybody's getting ready for tomorrow. But I did not want to leave tonight without doing our Torah Tuesdays because I do love Torah Tuesdays. I just started a new job. And I'm still getting used to the commute and figuring out what kind of hours I have to deal with. But I didn't want to leave today without going through our Torah Tuesday. And I'll try to make this in 1 hour. Long-winded, so that's a job for me. That's a real something I have to work towards. But I appreciate everybody that's watching right now. God bless you, Brother and Sister Macias. Hope I'm pronouncing that right. But thank you for understanding about the past few weeks. I injured my hip, and it's pretty much healed by now. But last time, I couldn't even sit in a chair. So praise be to God, I'm able to sit and teach today, and walk around and do all kinds of stuff now. But today, I'm not going to be long, or I'm not going to belabor the topic today. Tonight's topic for Torah Tuesday is Apostolic Kashrut, and for those of you that may not be familiar with the term Kashrut. That is referring to the dietary laws in the books of Moses and how it relates to us in the apostolic faith, those that are born again according to Acts 2.38, those that are not born again according to Acts 2.38, that's another subject. You have to get baptized in the name of Yeshua, filled with the Holy Ghost first, and then we can talk about everything else. But once you've been baptized in the name of Yeshua and filled with the Holy Ghost, speaking in tongues, then we can talk about these things. The mitzvot and how they affect us and so forth. I hope everybody has now enjoyed some nice, thick, fluffy bread. Praise be to God. Thank God the Feast of Unleavened Bread is now past. I know that I enjoyed some nice, soft white bread today, and it is just like manna from heaven after eating matzah for 8 days. It's so nice to be able to actually eat soft, fluffy bread, but it's a beautiful thing. I look forward to it every year, and when it's all over, I'm glad that I participated in the Feast of Unleavened Bread. I just taught this past Shabbat how that leavened bread originated with the Egyptians. So the Egyptians actually invented raised yeast bread, or actually it was more of a sourdough starter bread. And so that essentially leavening and raised bread was a sign of Egypt. It was an Egyptian food. So that when God commanded Israel to abstain from leaven for a week, and Passover including, that would be 8 days, really he was telling them to abstain from something having to do with Egypt. And of course, us apostolics know very well that Egypt represents the world. The secular society out there that is controlled by the flesh and ultimately the devil and the sinful nature of humanity with the flesh. So really what God is telling us and teaching us symbolically through fasting from unleavened or from leavened products is to separate ourselves from the things of the world and the things of Egypt. And really that's what Passover is. It is a type of fast. I know that every apostolic out there is very familiar, or should be anyways, with the notion of fasting. And really what Passover is, Pesach, is actually a fast. And like other fasts, it helps us to crucify our flesh, as we say, to keep our physical passions under control. And that's really the actual intention of Kashrut. And we'll get into that in a little bit. It really has nothing to do with the animal itself. We could go into different scientific things about pork and about different animals and so forth. Really, the real motive behind Kashrut is not so much that these animals are genetically defective or anything like that, or that they have some sort of biological uncleanness. There may be some of that there that is pertinent, but that's not the real reason for Kashrut. Even Orthodox rabbis will tell you today, if you actually study the works of rabbis, that the real reason for Kashrut is to keep our fleshly passions under control, and that God simply chose certain things to forbid us from eating so that we could have something there that our flesh wanted that we had to constantly say no to and constantly keep under subjection and constantly tame our fleshly desires. That's the real reason for kashrut. Pigs may be able to carry worms, and that's a disgusting thing, but you know, raw chicken will kill somebody and make them very sick also. And chickens are considered clean in the Torah and allowed to be eaten, whereas pigs aren't. So it's not necessarily some sort of biological thing that's the motive behind kashrut. but it's really, and there may have been things like that, especially in ancient times, that were the reasons God gave the dietary laws to Israel. But let me start off by saying tonight, first of all, my position on kashrut as far as my lifestyle, this is not in any way braggadocious because I consider myself a work in progress. As far as me and my house and in my own personal life, I do keep biblically kosher. It's not quite the same thing as rabbinically kosher, which is an even higher level of kashrut that I have a great deal of respect for. But I keep it biblically kosher as far as I don't eat pork and eel and shark and catfish and shellfish and things like that. I have no problem with mixing milk with meat. That's a rabbinical ruling and so forth. And I don't necessarily buy meat from the market that is marked with a certification of kashrut or hesher. But I do stick to the biblical animals that are allowed to be eaten. So that's my life. That's where I live. So just so everybody has a clear idea of where I'm coming from, I do keep kosher. I recently found an Orthodox kosher butcher that's nearby. And from the pictures on the internet, it looked like they had pretty decent prices. So I plan on checking that out. On the internet, I've found beef for like $17, $18 a pound, which is insane. I would never eat beef if I stuck to that. But the prices look pretty decent here in the East Bay. So I'm going to check that out. I would love to be able to afford and go that route if possible. But that's where I stand. That's where I live. Or how I live, just so everybody knows going forward. Let me say this starting out. The dietary laws, kashrut, is not something for people to get a holier-than-thou spirit about. For some reason in the Messianic circles that I see over and over again is that when people start taking on a kashrut and eating the biblical animals and not eating the unclean animals mentioned in the Torah, for some reason it seems to be something that people toot their own horn about a lot. And that's really not the spirit that should be, a person should have regarding this type of thing. Our righteousness is filthy rags before the Lord. Paul said, by works of the Torah, no flesh shall be justified. So we need to stay humble no matter what we are doing in those areas, no matter how holy we think we are. Kashrut is not somebody, it's not an issue or a topic or a way of living that you can use to make yourself, or that you should use to make yourself feel superior to somebody that doesn't follow kashrut. And that's sort of a pet peeve of mine. I really gets under my nerves when people walk around sort of tooting their own horn about, I've heard people say, bless God, I eat clean. Well, maybe you should start sort of thinking clean in your heart too, because that's sort of prideful to go around saying that. So please keep a level head when you do this. And this is not a holier than thou thing to make you feel better than regular Pentecostals. We should do this humbly out of sincere devotion before the Lord. And it's really between us and God. Like Yeshua said, you know, when you fast, don't disfigure your faces, which some people could refer to shaving. Don't make it so where the people, you know, see what you're doing so you can have praise of men. Even kashrut should be something that's very personal and really something taken with humility that you're not really bragging about. So that's my two cents about kashrut. I know Orthodox Jews and they don't have that attitude, at least not the ones that I've met. They're very quiet about it, and they're very personal about it. They won't even tell you unless you ask them. And it's a very, very sort of something that they try not to really make a big deal about around people that may not be kosher or eat kosher. So I would advise people in the Messianic movement to do the same. Let me just go into this right now. Let me give this story here right off the bat. So we may have people watching that have never tried Kashrut and tried to eat according to the original dietary plan in the Book of Moses, one of the original dietary plans. Let me give this little story just to give us a little perspective for those that may be right off the cuff dismissing Kashrut and just, you know, it's amazing. I was at an event recently, a church event, and the people there had some food being served for everybody in the church. And one of the dishes had, I believe it was bacon in it. And my wife refused. Well, she asked, is there bacon or pork in this? And the person said, yes. And my wife said, okay, I'll pass on that. And it was amazing how offended this particular sister in the church got. And I've seen this over and over, that how it's incredible how even when you are being humble and when you are being as discreet about it as possible, how offended people get when you refuse their ham or their pork. It's a really personal thing on either side of the coin. People that do eat get very offended that if you refuse their pork products, etc. And people that you know, abstain from pork and shellfish and so forth can get a very, you know, sensitive about it on their side also. So it's just something to think about, but it's just amazing. I've seen it over and over. But so, in case there's those out there that may be of the inclination that this is just all ridiculous, this is, why are you not eating pork? Why are you doing this and that? Just allow me to give you a little story real quick. I know somebody that's in the restaurant business in a certain city, which I shall remain nameless, that's very close to here, a very big city. And they work in the food industry, and the rumor going through the food industry was that certain employees were reporting their employers to the food services department. I guess it's the health services. I don't know the exact name of the city and county department that oversees food in restaurants and makes sure that it's all clean and so forth. But these employees were reporting their employers saying that they were ordering, it was either rat meat or cat meat. I think it was cat meat, and passing it off as chicken. And these are the people that worked in the restaurant saying they're ordering this meat that's like cat meat, and they're selling it as chicken. They're making this food. And so this was the inside scoop that I got from somebody in the food industry that they had heard going around the grapevine of the food industry in this city. And so I wanted to check it out and look online. I'll just say it's here in the San Francisco Bay Area, in San Francisco. This was the rumor going around. And so I wanted to find some verification for this. So I started Googling stuff and researching this. And sure enough, just a couple of years ago, there was a big bust at the shipping docks in San Francisco. A bunch of cargo was seized at the docks, and they found out that it was 1 million pounds of meat that was being sold throughout the Bay Area and other places, wherever it was sold, probably local, but it was being sold as chicken wings, and it was being sold right before the Super Bowl, when people make all these hot wings and these special wings for the Super Bowl parties and so forth. And as it turns out, it was not chicken. It was not a chicken wing at all. These were rat arms. They were actually the arms of rats that had been butchered in a way that they looked like drumettes, chicken drumettes. And 1 million pounds was shipped, and they were able to confiscate about 700,000 pounds. But 300,000 pounds of rat arms were still in restaurants being sold and eaten as chicken. So the next time you go out to eat, you might want to kind of give it a second thought. And when you realize that you might be eating something like a rat, you start to think twice about saying that you can eat anything under the sun. It starts to make a little bit of a make it a little bit more personal. But let me just start real quick by saying that there is nowhere in the scriptures that says that human beings can eat whatever they want ever. Give me 1 second. In the Old Testament, in the Tanakh, or in the New Testament, there's nowhere in scripture that just says human beings eat whatever you want. That's not in the Bible. Now let me just say this real quick, that what I might teach tonight is Ami's official position on Kashrut. It is Ami's official stance on the dietary laws throughout the Bible, and I probably will maybe offend or lose or upset people on both sides of the coin here. Maybe those that are not for Kashrut and those that are maybe getting legalistic with Kashrut, I'll probably maybe rub you both the wrong way. But what I'm about to go into tonight is Ami's official stance on Kashrut. And since it is now the end of Passover and we're able to eat bread again, and that was a sort of dietary restriction, I felt like it was a good time. Also because I keep seeing this topic pop up over and over and over and over again in social media threads. I put a post on the other day that Ami does not endorse 119 Ministries for various reasons. They're, number one, they're not apostolic, so they're really not qualified to teach New Testament whatsoever. Number two, in and of themselves, in and of their own doctrines, a lot of their stuff is off. It's very off, and it's really becoming a problem within the Messianic community. I just wanted to make a public position statement that Ami is in no way aligned with 119 Ministries. That's not to say that everything they put out is I disagree with. A lot of stuff they put out is pretty benign, but there are other things that they sort of decimate out there that it's really decimate. That's not really in line with what we believe at Ami and what I'm creating Ami to be. So just everybody knows that. But this is an issue that keeps coming up over and over again in the Messianic community, and I really feel like I need to give Ami's viewpoint on Kashrut. It is a very unique viewpoint, but I believe it is the correct one. Number one, we are apostolic, and we have a spiritual mind given to us by the Holy Ghost, the mind of Christ, a regenerate mind. And so we can really discern the scriptures in a way that other people cannot, and that's not to be arrogant in any way, but that's just New Testament scripture. So I'd be very careful and be very wary of taking New Testament teachers from people that are not even born again. So that's just another, you know, 2 cents I wanted to throw in there. So going into this, let me say again that there's nowhere in the scripture where it says you can just eat whatever you want. Matter of fact, if we look at the scriptures from a panoramic viewpoint from Genesis to Revelation, we really find that what we put in our mouths, what we eat, what we digest, what we consume, and what we put into ultimately is the temple of the Holy Ghost. God is really concerned about. God really does care about what we put in our bodies. So there are, throughout all of human history, God has always had certain things that were prohibited for us to consume and certain things that were allowed to consume. And let me just say this in the scriptures. There are things that today and in today's scientific world and our really sort of dualistic mindset that there's flesh and there's spirit, and that sometimes we get a little bit too Gnostic with that. We can get a mentality that certain things are just mundane. Eating is mundane, and so forth, and things like hair and appearances are just, you know, they're just things and they're just stuff. But if we look at the scripture, things that we think might be mundane are actually very important to God. I'm not going to go into it tonight. I'll do it in the future, but I will take a night in the future covering facial hair, and not just facial hair, but hair in general. Throughout the scripture, hair has very significant importance, going back to the Nazarites, going to the prohibitions on men to shave their faces, and going even into the New Testament, where women are prohibited from cutting their hair. So hair, something as mundane as protein strands hanging from our scalp, are actually very important to God. The same is true for food and for what we eat. We can think that, we think in terms of calories, we think in terms of trans fats and carbs and proteins and sugar content, and that's all good. I think we should do that, but it's more than that. What we put in our bodies is important to God, and it's not just physical material. God doesn't just see it as physical material. He sees it as things that He's created, and some things that He wants us to consume, some things that he would prefer us not to consume. There's nowhere in Scripture that says we can eat whatever we want, starting with the Garden of Eden. Let's go all the way back in time to the Garden of Eden. God creates the world. He creates Adam. And the first thing He does is He places Adam in the garden and begins to grow trees, grows the tree of life, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And the first dietary law in the Bible, the very first dietary law in the Bible, is given right there in the Garden of Eden. God says that Adam and later Eve are not allowed to eat of the fruit of the knowledge, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. So right there in paradise, really, in Eden, when we think that everything is just, you know, hunky-dory and it was sinless, even in a sinless state, even in an unfallen state, a state of innocence, a state of guiltlessness, before the fall of humanity, even in that perfect climate and setting, God still had a dietary law for humanity to follow, and that was not to eat of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Genesis 1 and 29, and God said, "Behold, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is on the face of the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit, you shall have them for food, and to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the heaven, and to everything that creeps on earth, everything that hath breath of life, I have given every green plant for food." And it was so. So in the original Garden of Eden, the entire creation, every animal entity, every whether it's a human, whether it was a four-footed animal, whether it was a bug, all the creatures, at least the land animals here, all of them had a vegetarian diet. In the beginning, the famous words, in the beginning, all the creatures, all the animals, including human beings aren't animals, but human beings and animals were all vegetarian. That was the original plan of God. Had Adam never fallen and man never fallen into sin, I have no doubt that vegetarianism would have been still the rule to this day. But in the beginning, before the fall, all the creatures that God created were vegetarian and commanded to be so. Eating meat was prohibited. Killing an animal, shedding its blood, and eating its flesh was absolutely forbidden. It was a sin. What God allowed human beings to eat and allowed other animals to eat, apparently at this time animals didn't kill one another, but what God did allow for humanity to eat was vegetation and fruit, produce, anything that grows from the ground, every plant, the seeds from that plant, and the trees and their seeds and the fruit were the food that God gave to mankind. So the food originally was a vegetarian diet, and if really probably more of a vegan diet, really. That's all in the Garden of Eden. Then we read in Genesis 2 and 16, and the Lord commanded the man, saying, "You may surely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die." And there is the first dietary law ever recorded in Scripture in the Garden of Eden. So that was the rules even in paradise, paradise on earth, that is. After the fall, the rules changed a little bit. It was changed in the sense that man was forbidden to even, find the tree of life and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil in that sense. But in the other areas, the dietary laws continued to be vegetarian for all of humanity. And Adam said, and to Adam he said, because you have listened to the voice of your wife and have eaten of the tree which I commanded you, you shall not eat of it. Cursed is the ground because of you. In pain you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Thorns and thistles it shall bring forth to for you. And you shall eat the plants of the field. You shall eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your face you shall eat bread, which comes from wheat and barley and so forth, till you return to the ground, for out of it you were taken, for you are dust, and to dust you shall return. So even after the fall, when Adam and Eve are kicked out of the garden, the dietary laws for humanity were still completely vegetarian. They were still not allowed to eat meat. They were still not allowed to kill an animal and to eat its flesh in any way, shape, or form. So that was the dietary laws after the fall. After the fall and before the flood. Now, let me just say this, that if we actually look at the entire gamut of scripture, you'll find that the dietary rules do change throughout human history. From the Garden of Eden to the flood, from the flood to Sinai, from Sinai to the New Covenant, and from the New Covenant into the millennial age or post-resurrection time period. And I'm sure there's things that God hasn't even told us about that time period. But we do see a little bit of possible change there. Actually, there is a change that I can see anyways. After the fall, mankind is still prohibited from eating meat, still a vegetarian diet, and it's a sin to consume animals. So fast forward here to Noah. Noah comes along. He's a righteous man. The perfect man finds grace and so forth. God tells him, we all know the story, get the animals into the ark, save them and so forth. There's too many scriptures here to go into. I'll just list them really quick. Noah essentially gathers all quote-unquote clean and unclean animals, basically all flesh, all kinds of animals, birds and creeping things and everything. Genesis 6:19, Genesis 7:2, Genesis 7:8, Genesis 7:14. Basically, you can look that up on your own. They all basically describe that Noah gathers in the clean and the unclean animals. Now, some of these animals are probably extinct today. We don't know exactly everything about these animals, but apparently the animals we have today come from the ark. So, he goes in and clean and unclean, puts them on the ark, and so forth. Now, there is an argument out there that's been going on for probably a couple decades. I know it's been at least like 17 years since I first heard it, and it's sort of like mutating and like a virus, and more that essentially Noah knew the Torah ahead of time. Somehow, supernaturally, he knew the laws of Moses. He knew the Torah. Apparently, he probably knew when Moses died also, but he knew the clean and the unclean animals and so forth, and that when, I'll get to this in a little bit here, the doctrine goes that essentially when God allows human beings to eat flesh, which we'll get to in a minute, that he still prohibited the unclean. I'm getting ahead of myself. Let me back up here. Genesis 8:20, then Noah built an altar to the Lord, and took some of every clean animal and some of every clean bird and offered burnt offerings on the altar. So Noah separated the clean and the unclean animals in the ark and for sacrifice. When Noah makes a sacrifice here, after the flood unto the Lord, he separates the clean from the unclean and he offers up the clean animals to sacrifice to the Lord. That is 100% sure. What is not sure is what those animals were. They may have been the same animals mentioned later on in Exodus and in Leviticus and Deuteronomy. They may not be. They may be animals that are extinct today. And that is a problem that we run into with Kashrut. For example, locusts are permitted in the Bible, in the Torah, to be eaten. It is locusts, the locusts mentioned in the Torah are kosher, or they're fit, they're clean. to be eaten. The problem is we do not know for certain with certainty that the same species of locust that the Torah mentions are the exact same species that exist today. We don't know that. And so some rabbis are hesitant to permit locusts to be eaten because, again, they may be completely different locusts that are mentioned in the Torah. And it's even more ambiguous with the animals that Noah separated today. They may be animals that no longer exist. We do not know exactly which ones he offered and which ones he didn't offer. This is also part of rabbinic lore that somehow that the Torah and even the Talmud are sort of pre-existent and known by Noah. And we need to be careful about absorbing rabbinic fables in certain areas because these things are a part of the oral law and the rabbinic traditions that have no basis in scripture. And so that may be where this sort of doctrine originated. There's no proof of that. There's no proof of exactly what the oral Torah was because it's not a documented thing until centuries and centuries later. So technically, we have no idea what these animals are, but we do know that whatever kind of clean animals existed in the ark, those are the ones that were offered up to the Lord, whatever they were. When we get to Genesis 9 and 3, God is now creating the Noahide covenant, which is a covenant that pertains to all humanity, Gentiles and Jews. This is, of course, before any Israelites or Jewish people existed. So this is a covenant with all mankind. And here at the Noahide covenant, let me just read it. Genesis 9 and 3, every moving thing that lives shall be food for you. And as I gave you the green plants, everybody say green plants, I give you everything. But you shall not eat flesh, everybody say flesh, with its life, that is its blood. So again, God is not saying, humanity, eat whatever you want to eat. Again, there is still a prohibition. Humanity is still not allowed to consume blood. And for your lifeblood, I will require a reckoning. From every beast, I will require it. And from man, from his fellow man, I will require a reckoning for the life of man. Whosoever sheds the blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed. For God made man in his image. So, what we have here is a paradigm shift. Because up until this point from the Garden of Eden to the post-flood era, mankind has been prohibited from eating any kind of animal, period. A vegetarian diet was the only kind of diet allowed, probably because of the sins of humanity, beginning with Nimrod, who began to kill animals, began to eat their flesh, probably, this is conjecture, but probably bloody flesh, probably uncooked raw meat. He was a mighty hunter before the Lord. So he was the people at this time were probably killing animals and eating them bloody, which was a sin. So after the flood, God permits mankind to begin to eat flesh, to begin to eat meat, with the stipulation that the blood must be taken out of that meat. And really the primary two ways of doing that is, well, there's a few ways, but you can essentially remove the blood by fire, by cooking it, or you can remove it with salt and soaking it in water, the kashering process, and then cook it, which is almost completely blood-free by then. But God allows humanity at this point to go from vegetarianism to being carnivores. They are now allowed to eat animals in general. And as long as that blood is taken out of the meat and as long as that blood is somehow removed, really by the process of fire, by the process of cooking that meat. Now, we know that Noah separated the clean from the unclean when he offers up the animals as a sacrifice to Jehovah. However, when we get to the verses where God permits humanity to eat animals and flesh, there is no distinction between the clean and the unclean made in the scriptures whatsoever. To say that there is would be to adding to the word of God and really inserting meaning there that is not there. What the scripture does tell us is that every moving thing that lives shall be food for you. As I give you the green plants, I give you everything. So, what's really going on here? The idea of the dietary laws in the Word of God, Kashrut, the idea there is the idea of holiness, sanctification. And as I taught a few weeks ago, holiness in the Scripture can be measured in degrees. Some things are holier than others. And we have a situation with the history of mankind here where mankind starts off in a holy state and even then has a prohibition of a dietary prohibition. Once he has fallen from grace and sin, he still has the same dietary restrictions pretty much, and that is vegetarianism. Mankind begins to fall deeper and deeper into sin and begins to eat raw flesh, and essentially to prohibit that, God is what I believe to be raw flesh. That's my own interpretation there. But for whatever reasons, God begins to allow humanity to not consume flesh as long as there is no blood. And as a holiness issue, what seems to be going on here, in my opinion, is that God is trying to preserve holiness within humanity. God would rather have humanity eating meat that has had the blood cooked out of it than eating it with the blood in it. So he allows humanity to eat flesh as long as there's no blood. But the holiness level there is still for any animal. God did not distinguish between the clean and the unclean as far as what is stipulated in the Noahide covenant. So in the Noahide covenant, mankind is allowed to eat any kind of animal, whether it's technically clean or unclean, as long as there is no blood in it. If God wanted them to not eat certain animals, what he really should have said here in Genesis 9 and 3 was that all the clean animals that I just got done sacrificing, or that Noah just got done sacrificing, those you can eat, everybody. But the ones that Noah didn't sacrifice, that the unclean ones on the other part of the ark deck, those ones you can't eat. That's what the Lord really should have said if that was the situation with the Noahide covenant. But that's not what the Word of God said. Very easily, God could have said that and could have said, just like he said with the sacrifice, hey, everybody, eat the clean ones Noah just offered. Don't eat the unclean ones. But the wording here is 100%, 180% diametrically opposed to that thinking. In verse 3, chapter 9, God says, every moving thing that lives shall be food for you. And I give you everything, all the flesh. Anybody that knows dietary laws, and especially people that live kosher, if you're trying to get somebody to eat kosher, you don't tell them every flesh and every living animal that moves is food for them. That's the opposite of what you want to tell somebody if you want them to start living according to Mosaic Kashrut. So the wording here is clear that for the Noahide level of Kashrut, that any animal is on the menu as long as there's not blood. So what am I talking about here? What I'm saying is that there are levels of holiness and there are levels in Kashrut holiness. And one level, the ultimate level of holiness as far as dietary restrictions are concerned, is what we find in the Garden of Eden. The highest level of Kashrut, the highest level of dietary law, is absolute veganism. Absolute veganism. That's the highest level of dietary restriction and holiness. A little bit below that, we'll get into that a little bit more, I don't want to get ahead of myself. Really, we'd probably have to go to the Mosaic Kashrut, which would be a little bit below that, and then, or a little bit above that. Actually, I'm getting mixed up here. Below that, Garden of Eden, Mosaic Kashrut, and then we would find the Noahide level of Kashrut, a little less holy, but still sufficient according to the Noahide covenant in any case. So the dietary laws are changing throughout the history of humanity. God is changing what is allowed, what is not allowed, and really is to preserve holiness in humanity. And the levels of holiness do differ at different times. So there are different levels of holiness within Kashrut. A little story I can tell you. One of my friends who is modern Orthodox was working at a Jewish organization, and this person that I know observes rabbinic kashrut, which everything that she eats has to have the kashrut certification, the chesher, showing that it's been handled and produced and certified by rabbis overseeing the kashrut food production, basically. And this person, a friend of mine, was in the break room. And in the break room was a certain rabbi that ate only what's called Pas Yisroel. Pas Yisroel is the highest level of kashrut that you can possibly find. The food that is Pas Yisroel is a food that from its very creation, from the time it's a vegetable, from the time it's planted to the time that it's reaped, to the throughout the processing and the manufacturing facility, to the time it's packaged and delivered, every single aspect of the food is overseen by rabbinic Jewish authorities. Every single aspect, and it's only handled. The food is actually only touched and handled by observant Jews that observe strict kashrut. And there was this rabbi sitting in the break room of this Jewish organization. And my friend, who was also kosher eating, had a microwavable pizza that was kosher. It was certified kosher. And it had a level of Orthodox rabbinic certification for kashrut. And she made her way to the microwave to put her pizza in the microwave oven, and very kindly, very gently, with a smile on his face in a very nice way, right before she could do that, this certain rabbi turned around and said, "Please don't put that in there." Because for him, it would have absolutely ruined the kosher status of that microwave, and he would not have been able to use that microwave anymore. In his opinion, it would have been defiled, essentially. And even though she is an observant Orthodox Jew that lives and eats kosher, there's levels within kashrut. Some are higher and some are lower. And the same is this is actually borne out in the Word of God as we're studying right now, the different levels of holiness within kashrut from Genesis and the garden to the flood and eventually to Israel. So, well, God's verbiage here is completely the opposite of what you would say to somebody trying to go kosher with certain animals being prohibited. That leads us up to Israel. Now, with Israel, God creates a nation and brings us to the Mosaic covenant. We skip the Abrahamic covenant, but coming up here to Israel, God is essentially creating a nation state, a people, out of not just the Hebrew lineage, but a mixed multitude. So that's a whole other Bible study. The Jewish people are not a race. I want everybody to understand that out there. That was something that the Nazis tried to propagate in the early 20th century, that the Jewish people are a race. And that's the rationale that they used to kill the Jewish people. The Jewish people are not a race. The Jewish people are a people. It's a different thing. Similar to being a citizen of the United States, you can be black, you can be white, you can be Asian. You can be any kind of race or ethnicity. Once you become a citizen of the United States, you're an American. And the same is true within Israel. You can be Chinese, you can be African, European, white, you can be Hispanic, and become a Jew, become an Israelite through conversion. And then your children, from that point on, will be Jewish. And that's the big question, who is a Jew? We won't get into that today. But I said that to say this, any ethnicity, any race can become a Jewish person, an Israelite, indeed, and being a Jew in all respects. The Jewish people are not a race, it is a people, it's a peoplehood. So God created his own people, primarily from the Hebrew lineage, but also other races involved there that accepted the Torah and became a nation. And what God is doing here is he's trying to elevate again the holiness of humanity. Mankind really, really, really fell to the point where they're eating flesh off of animals, in my opinion, like animals, and like Satanists do today, and pagans and so forth. So what he's trying to do is he's creating a holy people, a peculiar people, a holy nation, a nation of kings and priests, a peculiar holy people. So the Noahide level, it was better than eating blood. Mankind had fallen down to eating animals and eating blood. God had to bring up the level of dietary holiness a little bit more and prohibit blood, but allowed flesh to be eaten, any kind of flesh, pork, eel, whatnot. But when God created the holy nation of Israel, God's holy people, this level, this bar was too low. And so God is raising the bar of holiness in the dietary department. So God is raising the level of holiness in the Kashrut of Israel. And so for Israel, he actually names the specific types of animals that are prohibited and those that are allowed. Unlike in Noah's situation where God is silent on what kind of animals they are. God could have very easily put those animals in there, or what kind they were. But God leaves that as a mystery for us. They're not specific. They're not named whatsoever. So technically, we have no idea what those animals are. In Israel's situation, in Leviticus and Deuteronomy, etc., the animals are specifically named, which kind they can eat, which kind they can't, what their physical qualities are. That can and cannot be eaten, and God is doing is raising the level of holiness in the dietary department. It's all about ascension. It's all about elevation. It's all about moving up a little bit higher, as Mahalia Jackson sang so well. God is bringing up humanity to a higher level of holiness with the Torah, with the law of Moses, and with the nation of Israel, and creating an even holier people. And people that live at a holier level than the Noahide level. So that's what's going on there. Let me just say this real quick. There is an argument out there that I've heard that's sort of ridiculous. Some people try to twist New Testament scriptures and say, well, God never considered this other stuff, pork and so forth, food. And so when the Bible mentions foods, he's not even talking about pork. We'll get into that in a minute. That's not true. God knows that Gentiles eat pork. It is food for them, but for God's holy people, for Israel, God forbid it. It's food, but it's forbidden food for Israel. Deuteronomy 14:21, you shall not eat anything that dieth of itself. You shall give it unto the stranger that is in your gates, that he may eat it, or thou mayest sell it unto the alien, for you are an holy people unto the Lord your God. You shall not see the kid in his mother's milk. So right here in the theocratic state of Israel, in the Torah itself, God is saying this unclean meat, it was a clean animal, but it was considered unclean because it died of itself. So it's just as unclean as a pig at this point. It died of itself. Right here, God is saying, give it to the Gentiles that are visiting your country. You can give it to them or you can sell it to them. For them, it is food. You know, Israel was prohibited from eating it, but God here allows Israel to give it to the Gentiles to be sold or given for free as food. So to say pork is not food is just asinine. It's just a ridiculous argument. It is food, but it's considered unholy food. It's considered unfit, not kosher, for Israel. But God said you can give it to the stranger, to the ger, to the gerim. I'll just list these out here. Leviticus 17:15, Leviticus 22:8, talk about that which is torn by beasts and so forth. So that even the sojourner was considered unclean if they ate it, but God allowed it. God allowed them to eat it. They were considered ceremonially unclean, but God said you could give it to them to eat it. In any case, Aaron's sons were prohibited from eating these things again. Things that are torn or died of itself. In the book of Ezekiel 44:31, the priest shall not eat of anything that is dead of itself or torn, whether it be fowl or beast. So in the future, after the rapture, in the, I guess you could call the millennial age, again, we find that the Levites are still sticking to Kashrut very stringently. Okay, one second. There's no way that I can go over every aspect of Kashrut tonight. It's probably a topic we could go on for forever. But let me just read off a few New Testament scriptures here. In Matthew 15:11, Yeshua says, "Not that which goeth into the mouth defileth a man, but that which cometh out of the mouth, this defileth a man." Mark 7:20, and he said, "That which cometh out of the man, that defileth a man." Now, we will be here all night if I have to go into everything about the New Testament. Suffice it to say this, Yeshua was a strictly observant Jew, the perfect observant Jew. And so Yeshua did not eat or endorse the eating of unkosher food. So Yeshua is not here, he's not saying here that, especially for the Jewish people, that it's okay to eat pork. What he's saying here is that there are more important things in God's mind than eating bacon. What God is more concerned about. Now, God is concerned with both, but what God is more concerned about is about the thoughts of the heart, envyings, jealousies, hatred, murder, the evil eye, adultery, lasciviousness, the works of the flesh. If you're full of those things, God could care less if you're not eating bacon. At least the level of God's care is like this, whereas God's care for the other things is off the scales. Yeshua talks about the weightier matters of the Torah. Not all the matters of the Torah are equal. Some are weightier than others. Some are more important to God than others. So Yeshua, again, here is not saying, hey, Israel, eat all the bacon you want. What he is saying that there are more important things for them to keep in check. Let's move on. I'm trying to wrap this up because it is getting late. Acts chapter 10, the vision of Peter. As far as I'm concerned, I can see both sides of the argument on this. Some people say this, you know, allowed animals to be clean. Some say that, you know, it doesn't refer to that at all. I can see both viewpoints. I do have my own leaning and preference. I don't think that essentially pigs are now clean, but I do think that they're made a non-salvational issue. We'll go into that in a minute. Again, I'm pressed for time, so I can't go into everything like I can. Peter sees the vision of the sheet with all these unclean animals. Now, for us, it's real easy just to pull out the pig and say, you know, hey, the whole debate here is on bacon or ham. Let's just put the pig aside for a second, and let's realize what else is in the sheet. This great, huge, what probably is a talit, coming down from heaven. We have to realize that there were dogs and cats and rats and horses and all kinds of animals that we would probably vomit over trying to eat. Most of us, the idea of eating a dog or a cat just turns our stomachs and is absolutely disgusting. I find it hard to believe that God was telling Peter, it's okay to eat a dog, and it's okay to eat mice and rats and cats and all that type of thing. I don't think that's exactly what the Lord was saying. What I do believe that it was referring primarily to the Gentiles being received in the church, and that the dietary laws are not going to be salvational issues for them, and probably not for anybody really. Not to say that we shouldn't keep kosher, but we're talking about salvational issues here. Acts 15:20, 15:29, and 21 and 25 is the Jerusalem Council, the Apostolic Council, that essentially gave a halachic ruling, which in rabbinic terminology is a decision, a legal decision that's binding within Jewish law, on the determination of kashrut for Gentiles that are born again believers, and overriding Paul's authority, over and above Paul's authority, James and the elders there, the rest of the living apostles anyways, ruled that kashrut, the Mosaic kashrut anyways, in the Torah, the law of Moses anyways, pertaining to Israel, would not be something that would be coerced or compelled upon Gentiles to take upon themselves or to observe for salvation. Compelling means being made mandatory or absolutely required. The general tone and wording here is that it was not something that was going to be pushed upon the Gentiles. They would be free to observe these things willingly. And we know that the Jewish aspect of the church, all the way through pretty much to the end of the book of Acts, remained zealous for the Torah and completely lived Jewish lives, and part of that being kashrut. So the Jewish church kept kashrut, and apparently, in my opinion, led by example with regards to Gentiles. They didn't beat Gentiles over the head with kashrut. They didn't threaten them with hell or twist scripture to make to turn it into legalism. They didn't coerce the Gentiles. They didn't compel them. Maybe they encouraged them in a positive way, but in a non-threatening, non-invasive, pushy way. More likely, they led by example. And Paul gave some arguments in this area. But essentially, it's not a salvation issue. But it is, again, the idea of holiness. Not that the law of Moses is higher than Yeshua's version of the Torah and interpretation and implementation of the Torah. Yeshua brings it up to an even higher level in really every area. In the area of dietary kashrut, I would say that abstaining from pork and et cetera and shellfish is a level of holiness that is higher than eating those same animals. So, not a salvational holiness where God's going to send someone to hell or kick them out of the, forbid them from entering the pearly gates whatsoever, but I would say that it's definitely in the dietary department just by itself, in bodily holiness in that area, a higher level of holiness. I'm trying to wrap this up in the next 5 minutes. Romans 14, 4 and 1, you can read it yourself. One person believes he may eat anything while the weak person eats only vegetables. Again, even to this day, there are Jews that believe that the highest level of kashrut is pure vegetarianism, and that's probably what was going on back in the first century also. Let not one who eats despise the one who abstains, and let not one who abstains pass judgment on the one who eats, for God has welcomed him. So again, the argument there being kashrut, specifically here they're talking also about food offered to idols, which again, there's two different sides to. But in the overall context, the obvious issue here is kashrut, Mosaic kashrut. It's obvious. It's a Jewish church discipling Gentiles that are new to kashrut. Verse 5, the one who eats in honor of the Lord, since he gives thanks to God, while the one who abstains in honor of the Lord and gives thanks to God. Again, James and the Apostolic Jerusalem Council made a ruling that is binding upon all believers. They had the authority from Yeshua, when God said, I give you the authority to bind and loose. Whatsoever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatsoever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Essentially, the ability to make a halachic ruling. Some people call it a takanot. But they made a Jewish legal ruling here on this issue. And that was that kashrut would not be something required for salvation, more specifically with the Gentile people. We could debate, I'm not even going to get into that tonight. Verse 14 here, Paul says, I know I'm convinced of the Lord Jesus, that Lord Yeshua, that there is nothing unclean in itself. Still, it is unclean to the one who considers it unclean. That's almost like blasphemous words to somebody that's adhering to kashrut. But Paul said it, and he had the authority to say it, and that's the word of God for us. He says that it's, and we can go around all day. This is Ami's position. Ultimately, it's not an issue of uncleanness that prohibits someone from going to heaven, essentially. Verse 17, the kingdom of God does not consist of food and drink, but righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Colossians 2, therefore let no one judge you with respect to food or drink, on the matter of feasts or new moon or Sabbath days. Three issues there being kashrut, Shabbat, and Moedim. And he goes into a little bit of the rabbinic rulings that were just simply the commands of men in verse 21. However, in verse 16 and 17, he says these are only the shadow of things to come, but the reality is Christ. Verse 16, when he's talking about food, drink, feasts, and the Rosh Kodesh, and the new moon, Sabbath days, those are biblical commandments. Those are not the commandments of men. And so that is kashrut, Shabbat, and Moedim right there, that Paul is saying, don't let anyone judge you with respect to these things. That goes both ways. So those of us out there living a Torah-based life and eating kosher, etc., and celebrating and observing Shabbat, we have a biblical right to do so. And we have a biblical right to not be judged by other people that don't do it. So that's that there. But those are the things in the Word of God that Paul calls the shadow of things to come. Paul does not call the man-made commandments of men the shadow of things to come. He calls the biblical commandments shadow of things to come. The do not handle, do not taste, do not touch are probably referring to rabbinic things such as separation of meat and milk, things like that. 1 Timothy 4 and 3, verse 1, now the Spirit explicitly says that in the later times, how many know that we're living in the later times? Some will desert the faith and occupy themselves with deceiving spirits and demonic teachings, which is why I say over and over again, apostolic people, if I can just speak to you candidly, be careful about going to non-apostolic people for Judaism or for Messianic teaching. There are deceivers out there that are not born again, and their mind is not regenerated by the Holy Ghost or the blood of Yeshua. Why in the world would you go to some so-called Torah teacher that doesn't have the Holy Ghost, that's not baptized in the name of Yeshua, has not been born again to have the spiritual mindset of the mind of Christ? So what, they're teaching Torah? Big deal. So what? That doesn't mean that they're in the sound doctrine of the new birth. And so you're setting yourself up to receive false doctrine for sure. If you want Judaism, go to Jewish people, the traditional Jewish people, and study it from scholars, from the Jewish people themselves, and then combine your apostolic knowledge of truth with that Judaism to weed out the rabbinic stuff that's incorrect there. That's my recommendation. Timothy warns us here. Paul warns Timothy that in the last days that there will be these type of teachers out there, demonic teachings, influenced by the hypocrisy of liars whose consciences are seared. They will prohibit marriage and require abstinence from foods that God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and know the truth. For every creation of God is good, and no food is to be rejected if it is received with thanksgiving, for it is sanctified by the word by God's word and prayer. Again, that is antithetical to someone trying to get somebody to eat kosher as far as the Mosaic Kashrut is concerned. If I was trying to get someone to eat kosher according to the law of the Torah and the, of Moses that God gave to Israel, the last thing I would tell them, I would never tell them that every creature is of God and that they can eat anything and nothing is to be rejected and it's all to be received. So, but that is what Paul said. So, what's going on here is for Gentile believers in the church, especially, and really for people that are born again, the bar that is set to get into the pearly gates is at the Noahide level, is essentially where that's at. What God is saying here is that for New Testament believers in Yeshua, because the ruling set in the Council of Jerusalem in the book of Acts, mentioned three times, Acts 15, twice in chapter 15 and once in chapter 21, essentially the apostolic council, the halachic ruling that they gave there is almost identical to the Noahide law. So really what the original apostolic Jewish leadership of the church is, with authority from Yeshua, with essentially what they're doing is that they're setting the bar of holiness for salvation at the Noahide level. You can always go up in the dietary laws for the laws of Moses as far as kashrut is concerned in the dietary area. Yeshua's teachings were stricter than Moses in every way. But for salvation, it's at the Noahide level. The Apostolic Council's rulings was almost identical to the Noahide level. So really that's what's going on in the church. And that's really what Paul is saying here. We can live at the Mosaic level, which I think is a better way to live. And it's a beautiful thing. I believe that there will be kashrut at the highest level in heaven. Praise God. And I will say this in closing. Those of you out there that have not tried to take upon yourselves the kashrut mentioned in the Torah, it's a beautiful thing. Will you go to hell if you don't? No. But I strongly encourage you to try it and to, you know, try it out for yourself. For me, it's an absolutely beautiful thing. And it really is something that God dealt with me in my heart and spirit to live out, not for salvation, but because I feel like out of personal conviction, that's where God and how God wants me to live. And it really, really just, the more I get into kashrut, the more I get into eating in that way, the more and more I glean from it and more it means to me. These things were dietary rules and that Jewish people died over and refused to eat pork upon pain of death. But it really, really, in a nutshell, you won't be able to really understand what I'm trying to say inadequately unless you do it. That's the only way to really get this. But the more I do it, the more I live in, or eat kosher, the more it really sort of helps me to realize the sanctity of the human body and God's will for our flesh. And it really does help us to sort of be mindful of how we treat our bodies and in moral ways and in just health ways, and that this is the temple of the Holy Ghost. And I know I have a ways to go for overall health, but it has really become a beautiful thing in a spiritual way for me. And I encourage you to try it out. And it's really just, I think I'll end it upon this. Most Pentecostal people know what fasting does for your life and how it helps you to see spiritually. You crucify your flesh, quote unquote, and you put the plate aside. You deny your flesh something that it wants, and it helps you to stay focused on spiritual things, and it helps you to keep your passions in check. That's what kashrut is. Kashrut is a fast from certain foods that is an indefinite fast. It has no end date. you were fasting from this thing, really until the Lord returns. So there was something constantly that you were always denying your flesh out of devotion and out of your spiritual walk with God. And so this is Ami's official standpoint on it. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing. I love it. I encourage people to do it, to try it, and try it. I believe you'll like it. And it, the more you do it, the more meaningful it will become to you. And I believe it is beneficial and edifying for your spiritual walk. And I do believe it pleases the Lord more than eating these foods. I believe it pleases the Lord more not to eat these things than to eat these. It's not salvational, and it's not to be coerced upon anybody. But I do believe it's a beautiful thing. As Martha Stewart used to say, it's a good thing. So with that, Lord bless you, and I hope everybody has a great remainder of your week. Thank you for being here with a late night edition of Torah Tuesdays. And Shavua Tov, a late Shavua Tov, and until next time.